The brain is an incredibly complex organ. Millions of cells have to work in perfect concert to send all the right signals at all the right times for things to function. So it should come as no surprise that there's quite a bit of variation in how brains work. And scientists are working to understand how differences in brain structure and signaling can lead to different conditions, disorders, and diseases. This week on Neurotransmissions, we're going to talk about one such condition, Tourette syndrome. And we have a special guest joining us to talk about it. Hey!
Yes?
Inace Dawson is a graduate student at Oxford University and the creator of Draw Curiosity, a YouTube channel stimulating curiosity for science. Thanks for joining us, Inace.
Thanks for having me.
You've probably seen Tourette syndrome portrayed in the media, usually by awkward characters whose defining trait is coprolalia, the involuntary use of vulgar or offensive language. But it turns out that that's only one small part of the condition, and not everyone has the same symptoms. Right, Inace?
Right. Tourette syndrome is characterized by repetitive and stereotyped vocalizations and movements known as tics. These can be small and simple, such as blinking or clearing your throat, or they can be a lot more noticeable, such as touching or tapping objects, barking or uttering words and phrases. In my case, I find that I tend to blink a lot, and I also have this tooth-biting tic, and I also tend to squeak a lot. I also have something known as echolalia, where I tend to repeat words and sentences said by other people. Coprolalia is actually only found in 10 to 15% of people with Tourette syndrome, and people find that tics tend to come and go, and they vary in severity depending on the context. For instance, tics tend to be at their worst during your teens, and then they go into decline as you enter adulthood. Stress and excitement tend to make tics a lot worse, and also, interestingly, suppressing your tics or attempting to suppress them will generally make them worse later on in the day. It's a pretty complex condition, but what causes it?
Well, scientists have learned that in most cases, Tourette syndrome is inherited. If a parent has the condition, there's about a 50% chance that their child will too. It also seems to be linked to some kinds of obsessive-compulsive disorder, as in Inace's case. With all of those symptoms, it's definitely a neurological disorder. But what's happening in the brain to cause it? We're still trying to understand it, but researchers think that the disorder hinges on the basal ganglia. The basal ganglia is a set of brain regions located at the base of the forebrain, underneath the cortex, consisting of the dorsal and ventral striatums, the globus pallidus, the ventral pallidum, the substantia nigra, and the subthalamic nucleus. This circuit is important for a lot of things, but one of its biggest roles is to help modulate and control movement. Problems with the basal ganglia pathway have been connected to a lot of different conditions, including Parkinson's disease, ADHD, OCD, and addiction.
It's difficult to study Tourette syndrome in the brain directly because it's such a variable condition, but scientists have noticed a few things so far. When looking at the brain of people with Tourette's in an MRI machine, they noticed that on average they had a smaller basal ganglia than people without the condition. They also noticed that they were able to use this information to be able to predict whether tics were going to persist into adulthood or not. People who had smaller dorsal striatum in childhood were more likely to have more tics during adulthood.
In another very small study, scientists were able to examine the brains of deceased Tourette patients and found that there was a change in the numbers of different kinds of neurons within the basal ganglia. In some places, there were more than usual, and in others, fewer. This leads scientists to suspect that the condition is a result of differences in the wiring in the basal ganglia circuit. One theory is that this is specifically a result of changes in dopamine signaling, a neurotransmitter involved in reward pathways, but also an important part of movement control in the basal ganglia. Some researchers have found evidence that Tourette patients have more synapses sending dopamine signals in the ventral striatum than non-affected patients. So maybe Tourette patients have too much dopamine, or maybe their brains respond to it differently than other people.
Regardless of the exact cause of Tourette syndrome, there are a number of medications and treatments out there. Now, not everyone requires medication and therapy for Tourette's. Honestly, it's an entirely personal decision that's up to the person who has it to decide whether they need it or not. For people who find that tics are disruptive of their everyday life, they may be prescribed medications such as haloperidol, aripiprazole, also known as Abilify, or Pimazide. These drugs are dopamine antagonists, which means that they block dopamine receptors in the brain, meaning that the dopamine released has less of a strong of an effect. This lends support to the fact that Tourette's is most likely a dopamine imbalance, because they do help in preventing tics from occurring in the first place and also reduce the severity of the tics overall. People with Tourette's often also have other comorbid disorders such as anxiety, depression, or OCD, and for those they may be prescribed different types of medications such as SSRIs or selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors.
In addition to medication, behavioral training can be used to reduce tics by making patients more aware of their tics and encouraging individuals to replace the tic with alternative, less disruptive movements and sounds. Basically, it's a way to build habits to reduce tic severity. And supportive cognitive behavioral therapy with a psychologist can help individuals with Tourette navigate the personal and social impacts of the condition, especially the negative self-perception that can come with having Tourette. Overall, any treatment for Tourette syndrome is about finding a balance that's right for the patient.
In my case, I simply went about diagnosing my tics later in life just to make sure they weren't anything worse. Personally, I don't feel I need medication to keep them under control, but with my tooth biting tic, I do occasionally wear a mouth guard when it gets out of hand, just to protect my teeth. Otherwise, I found that the best policy is simply to just ignore my tics, because the less importance I place on them, the better behaved they are.
Tourette syndrome might not be the condition it's portrayed as in the media, but it's still a fascinating case of what happens when a brain functions just a little bit differently. Thank you so much to Inace for joining us today. If you haven't already, you should head over to her channel, Draw Curiosity, and check out the awesome videos she's been making. She talks about all kinds of science topics, from pie to rainbows to bumblebees. And check out the other video she and I made together about vision, context, and tricking your brain. Thanks for sharing your time with us, Inace.
Thank you very much for having me, Ellie.
And thank you for watching this episode of Neurotransmissions. If you liked it, hit the thumbs up button. And if you haven't already, subscribe so you can catch the next awesome collaboration video we create. If you're really excited about what we do, please check out our Patreon. We have a ton of fun making these videos, and your support means a lot. Until our next transmission, I'm Allie Astrocyte. Over and out.